So welcome to the Young Orphans. I'm Bonnie Close, president of Historic Red Hook. It is a pleasure to have another program here in the Young Orphan, our wonderful 18th century tavern that is Red Hook's oldest public building. And it's even more appropriate to have a program that is going to be talking about a topic that has its roots in the 18th century. So we're going to have a presentation. Then after the presentation, Q&A. Please join us after the program. We have refreshments in the other room, in the tap room, which is where people would normally assemble back in the 18th century. We hope that also, if you are not a member yet of Historic Red Hook, we have membership envelopes. Even if you don't, you could even sign up for our newsletter without even becoming a member. Of course, we'd like you to be a member. Some of you know Maynard Hamm, and he always does these little handouts of synopses of the Red Hook Journal from years back. This is 1868, so if you'd like to little snippets about what life was like at Red Hook in 1868, please help yourself. And just a couple of words about a major upcoming program that we have on June 9th, and that's our Preservation Expo. If any of you know anybody who has a historic house or barn, any old structure, and wants to know what to do about it, we are going to have on Saturday, June 9th, our fourth Preservation Expo. And we're going to have a whole group of experts in the preservation trades, architects, planners, designers, people who know how to talk about how to research your building. So please spread the word. It'll be on our bulletin. It's going to be in the news. So we hope we get a good turnout and good weather. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Dr. Tom Dorman, who is an associate professor of history at Marist College, and we are honored to have him here to talk about a skeleton. I had no idea, I confess, what a skeleton was. So I'm looking forward to finding out.
We just jump right in and find out what a skimmleton is and talk a little bit about what I hope to do. What is an old-fashioned skimmleton? Well, why not go, I guess I should, to a 1947 Poughkeepsie Journal article, which because of trying to fit this on the screen, you couldn't get the date in and things, but I'll just read the top two paragraphs. Myers Corner couple feted by neighbors at Skimmleton. Mr. and Mrs. Lorenzo Acker of Myers Corners, married last Saturday, were given an old-fashioned skimmleton and a party by neighbors and friends on Wednesday night. The couple were taken for a ride around the neighborhood and then through the streets of Wappinger, after which they returned to the Acker home, their home, for the party. Games, music, and dancing was enjoyed along with refreshments. Now, I could give you dozens of examples like this from the local papers, from papers in Poughkeepsie Journal, Kingston, New Paltz, Red Hook, Rhinebeck, of an old-fashioned skimmleton. Very common, very popular in the early 20th century, 19-teens, 20s, 30s, 40s. Has anyone heard previously of a skimmleton? No, maybe. Oh, yes. Oh, good, good, good. Well, this was one, right? So a skimmleton essentially was a party given by neighbors to a newlywed couple. In the 1940s, when this one took place, the one thing different about this one, perhaps, is I feel is pretty common, or at least representative. One thing that's a little bit different is that it doesn't say when it took place. Usually a skimmleton took place at night. And not necessarily the night that the couple was married, but within a few nights of their marriage. And the other thing that's not mentioned here, but very common would be in lots of other articles, is that a skimmleton, the crowd came, it was a surprise. Not too much of a surprise, because couples kind of had a sense that something was coming, it was so popular. But they would come at night, usually into the newlywed's front lawn. They would have pots and pans and bang them, and they would have horns and drums, firecrackers, and the Catskills, they'd bring guns and shoot guns in the air as well, to wake everyone up and get the skimmleton going. And essentially, the skimmleton was that the couple was supposed to come out, the new wife was supposed to take a little bow, and they were supposed to invite folks in for refreshments. Or sometimes folks even brought their own refreshments. So this is very much a classic skimmleton. Now, does that mean you were a member? You said you've heard of it previous?
According to what I heard, sometimes they were completely surprised and they were already in bed when...
Well, let's face it, the idea was, wherever this went back to in terms of its historic origins, the idea, since it wasn't taking place on the wedding night itself, by the way, this was not the wedding reception. The folks had had their wedding reception. They had family and friends. This was the neighborhood coming out more or less to welcome this new household within their neighborhood.
Yes. I think many times it occurred after they came back from their honeymoon.
Yes, exactly. In fact, this one, well, this one that had just been married, but others that I've seen after they returned from the honeymoon. And certainly symbolically, the idea was by doing it at night, they were going to try to interfere in the newlyweds' attempt to consummate their new marriage, at least symbolically by doing this. That's certainly the origins. However, this old-fashioned skimmleton, which is this very pleasant, friendly event, a generation earlier would have been seen and understood very differently here in Hudson Valley. By the way, skimmleton is only in the Hudson Valley. You will not find the term used for anything as far north as Albany. You'll find them in Columbia County and Greene County, all the way down to Westchester and Rockland counties. You'll find it a little bit in the edge of southwestern Connecticut, Fairfield County, kind of just over the border from Putnam County. And you'll also see it in northeastern New Jersey, but really just the Hudson River part, 20 miles or so there in the Hudson. So the skimmleton is a uniquely Hudson Valley event. Other parts of the country had things like serenades and shiveries, but the skimmleton has its own history, its own origin, only found here in the valley. Now, there's a lot of text here, and I probably should put it into two slides, but it seemed bigger when I did it. But from two generations earlier, in the 1870s, 1874, Kingston Daily Freeman, this comes from a newly married woman, Alicia Slider. She was a widow who had a grown son at this point, but was married, and this is her giving this to the local paper. Actually, this is a deposition. We were married Sunday night, 2nd of April, so the attack was made on Monday night, the 3rd. The attack lasted, notice, different use of term, attack. This is a very different type of event. Just at dark, they commenced their skimmleton. And now I actually skipped, there's a longer article, so cut through a few things. Finally, someone in the crowd said, let's load up and shoot in the house. And then we went into the rear room of the house. They fired through the house, threw stones and fire stones in the windows. There were 14 to 16 panes of glass that were broken. I should think there were 50 persons in the company, this is Alicia's speaking. They were very noisy. They sang vulgar songs, very common in the 19th century skimmleton. They swore, they hurrahed, and acted as they generally do at skimmletons up there. By the way, this is Pine Hill, just near Kingston. They had horns, bells, guns, tins they drummed on, and had clubs with which they pounded the fence. Now, I can give you, I should open this door.
Part of the job.
Here, this is very much a common 19th century skimmleton. So when they were talking in that earlier article about an old-fashioned skimmleton, something that had happened previously, this was an old-fashioned skimmleton. This is really what one was like. Now, I'm going to just kind of quickly go back genealogically here to the origins of this, because you're thinking, first of all, what is a skimmleton? Why were these things held? Who participated in it? Why the word? What does it even mean? Well, a generation earlier, and I'll explain some of these terms, back in the 18th century, there was something else unique to the Hudson Valley called riding skimmington, or a skimmington ride. And riding skimmington was, again, you can only find it in the Hudson Valley and a little bit into southern New England. It was a form of vigilantism. It was kind of community violence, the town or village coming together. And the target of a skimmington ride in the 18th century Hudson Valley was, it was always a man, an adulterer. I just lied to that because I have an example of a woman too. But an adulterer or a husband or father who was abusive to his spouse or children. They would be the targets of a communal action called a skimmington ride, which, as it sounds, was on a riding or a railing on a pole would be involved. You think that the old saying about running someone out of town on a rail, you know, on some sort of wooden pole. A skimmington ride in the 18th century Hudson Valley was exactly that. Might first be a threatening action to kind of threaten someone to change their behavior, and if the behavior didn't change, it would lead to this other event. I'm going to come back to this in a second, because even though these things are uniquely Hudson Valley and had their own kind of organic history here, Skimmington Rye actually goes back a century earlier, back to England. It's a 16th, 17th century English event or ritual. That, in fact, is the origins of the Skimmington Rye. And it also is a form of community vigilantism, community policing. And it's important to, you know, point out, 17th century, 18th century England or North America, Hudson Valley, there are no real policing forces to speak of, right? Police forces are a 19th century innovation. Policing was done by the sheriff, an elected position in Dutchess County or in Ulster County or in the borough in England. The sheriff didn't really have any deputies. He might have to put a posse together at certain times. So policing, when it took place for behavior that was seen as either dangerous to the community or even illegal, often was members of the rest of the community coming together. This would be very common in England, common throughout Europe in the 16th, 15th, 16th, 17th centuries, very common in early America as well, where folks more or less, you know, the word vigilantism, and it is vigilantism, often has a certain connotation. Vigilantism associated with lynching, things like that, that somehow is against the law. In the 17th and 18th century, vigilantism was really very often how legal actions worked themselves out, in which the community kind of took matters into their own hands. But the origins were in England in the 16th, 17th century, so I'm just going to start there and kind of just quickly bring it up. How did something called a Skimmington Rye, whatever it means, start in England and end up in Red Hook, as we'll see, in the 20th century? And this is an 18th century, by Hogarth, a rendition of a Skimmington Rye. And Skimmington Rye could be aimed in England in the 16th, 17th century at a whole variety of targets. Could be someone who was a thief, and, you know, again, trying to send a message, so some sort of theatrical ritual called a Skimmington would take place. It could be a prostitute. It could be a shopkeeper whose behavior, the types of transactions he entered into with his community might be seen as threatening. So a Skimmington Rye was the way in which the village came together and kind of sent its message. However, primary target of something called a Skimmington. Ridings and railings were fairly common. A Skimmington was a household with a domineering wife, a dominant woman, a masterful woman. That was the original target of the Skimmington. And just about all of the images I'm going to show on the 17th century English Skimmington, Skimmington, are related to that. And just to give you a sense, so, actually, it wasn't necessarily the woman. It was the household which was being targeted, because there was something awry here as far as the folks were concerned. In a patriarchal society of 16th, 17th century Europe, there was a clear gender hierarchy of who was supposed to be in control and who else was subservient. When folks found that to be out of kilter, with a woman who was masterful or dominant, or in some cases had beaten her husband, or at least was seen as the controlling force in the household, that was seen as a problem. And so the idea of the Skimmington Rye was a theatrical performance outside the home of that couple. And it included what was called rough music. It would be men and women with drums and horns and all kind of discordant images, instruments, kind of making this rough music, but it would also include a parade on a donkey, usually sometimes a gray horse or a gray mare, and it would be the two people pretending to be the husband and wife, sitting back to back on the horse, and paraded around the home of the offending couple. And the way they would sit would be, again, back to back. And the origins of the term comes from Skimmington actually originated in southwest England, although ridings took place throughout England, but in southwest England is where the term emerges. And linguists and anthropologists think that it refers to the thing that she is holding in her hand. That is dairy country in southwest England. Butter, cheese making, and she has a skimming ladle. A ladle that would be used to kind of take off cream from Stewart's or other places from the product. And in 16th century England, the farm, the fields were the domain of the father and the husband. The dairy was the possession of the wife and the mother. And so the idea of the Skivington Rye, which was being was named for as a form of gender inversion, kind of the dominant woman beating her husband with a ladle. So that 1947 Skimmelton that we started with in Poughkeepsie, or Wappingers Falls, has its origins back here in the Skimmington in the 17th century. Although we'll see it kind of change in terms of its going. Just to give you I'm going to come back to that. But here's another example, also from the 18th century, of the Skimmington Rye. Notice the wife also has that skimming ladle there, you can see it. The husband is kind of broke. So again, this kind of imagery that the husband is not fulfilling his role as head of the household. So this is the origins of the Skimmington. In the mid-18th century, the Skimmington makes its way across the Atlantic to North America. And the first one we know about, 1751, in Poughkeepsie. And you won't find a Skimmington this time in New Jersey or South. Again, you won't find it in New England outside of southern Massachusetts and Rhode Island. So it's something which transplanted itself in the 1750s into the Mid-Hudson Valley. Very common in the 18th century in Dutchess and Westchester counties in particular. So and I already pointed out that the 18th century Skimmington, that event which was aimed at a masterful woman, the term that they in the 17th century. In the 18th century, the idea of the ritual continued, but now it was aimed instead, again, at husbands who were not doing, so it's still very similar, actually, think about it. Both are aimed at marriage. Both are aimed at what's going on within the household, the domestic relations between the husband and the wife. 17th century, it's very concerned with whether or not the husband is acting like he should be running the household, and whether or not the wife is acting like she should be, in 17th century terms, subservient. In the 18th century, the target now becomes adulterous husbands. The focus is on the man. It's aimed at, again, those husbands who are abusive in some way towards their wives or their children. Now, let's give one example. There's dozens that we can call from. In Rye, New York, in the 1750s, Ezekiel Holdridge, he's married, had a wife, two children. One day in the mid-1750s, he just kind of, he walked off. And he made that long trek across the border to Connecticut, which is just a couple miles, and remarried, lived in Connecticut for a couple of years. And for the next couple of years, the people of Rye, through their poor relief and so forth, took care of his wife and two children as they were growing. Some point, two or three years later, he came back with his other wife and moved back into the same home which he had lived in previously with his first wife and their two children. Now, this lasted for about a week before the people of the town found this intolerable. For a variety of reasons. They saw it in terms of moral reasons, ethical reasons, and so forth, but also clear economic reasons. They had taken care of this family for the last couple of years. And here this guy was out there and now coming back and just kind of put it in their face. So they decided to ride him Skimmington. And they grabbed him, and a crowd of 30 or 40 people participated in this. The records of this are in the New York Historical Society and the Attorney General's file, John Taper Kemp. They grabbed him, they beat him, they spit on him, they burned his hair. They made him kind of run a gauntlet, and then they put him on the rail. And they rode him around town on a rail, a wooden rail, which was often had certain sharp spots along it. That was part of the potential punishment which might emerge. One reason why riding a rail was considered something to avoid. When they, or why they did it, to punish the person. When they finished, they did it again in the afternoon because they felt some people had missed it. Everyone was going to get a chance to participate in this ride. Now, we know so much about this case because he brought his case to the Attorney General, said, look, you know, I was speed and all these things happen. So we have depositions and they're historical of about 15 people and letters that they wrote explaining what happened, and no one denied it. They said, yeah, this is what happened. The guy had to get married again. He abandoned his wife and child. Now he's a bigamist. We rode him Skimmington. We beat him. We did these things, but he really wasn't hurt. He was saying he was hurt badly, and they said he really wasn't. But they didn't deny it. The Attorney General didn't pursue any charges. Kind of looked at it, said, well, it's all worked out. It's all kind of, he brought this on himself, more or less. And plenty other examples of 18th century Skimmingtons. And then again, can give them, and the virtually all of them, again, are at adulterers or folks abusing their children or wives. One stands out because it was aimed at a prostitute, actually, in Fishkill. But that one's kind of a curious one. But virtually all of the others are again aimed here at men. So a kind of reversal of that earlier one. Now, in the throughout, so 1750, 1760, 70s, through the revolutionary years, and think about it, the revolution has lots of crowd violence anyway, tarring and feathering and things like that, carding, but the Skimmington, which also took place, was always focused around what went on in the household. Different from those other railings or other ridings or tarring and feathering, they might be about political things or riots against shopkeepers who were price gouging, but a Skimmington riding, when that was named, that was specifically about something that was going wrong within that family. I should make reference to, in northeastern New Jersey, they didn't call it a Skimmington, but there was something called a group of men called the Regulators, who in the 1750s, 1760s, there's at least five examples of this in Elizabeth, New Jersey, Newark, a couple of other towns, of a group called the Regulators, men coming to the house of someone accused of abusing his spouse, dragging him out in the middle of the night, whipping him, which is very much like a Skimmington, no railing, but the way they did it, they dressed as women in their actions. They dressed in women's clothes, and that's how they were identified, the Regulators. Again, some sort of gender inversion going on. These were men who were doing this. The authorities saw it as a problem. Similar to a Skimmington, no railing, again aimed at domestic situations. So you're thinking, well, how does all this connect up to that 1947 or even that 1884 banning on marriage? And we start to see that in the early 19th century. There's too much text here, and I'll read some of it, but in the early 19th century, we start to see the Skimmington change from this rustic, rural violence, community violence, vigilantism aimed at abusive men, and becomes a much more carnivalesque kind of parade and ritual aimed at a new marriage, but specifically an unpopular new marriage. Those were the ones which Skimmingtons and Skimmingtons in the early 19th century. So just an example here, one from Courtright in the Catskills. Strangely enough, the first only example we have of one like this is again in Poughkeepsie in about 1819, 1820. But here's a great one in Courtright, 1822. I'll just read it. It was the marriage of Mr. Tripp and Abby Leon. Tripp was remarried. He was a widower. This was his second wife, which is not unimportant in the context of Skimmington in the 19th century. About sunset, the Skimmingtonians, they even had their own phrase for it, assembled together with their instruments of music, which they'd been preparing for some 3 days before the event, before the marriage. The number of them was 30 to 40, which chose their captain and was formed in a line two abreast. They marched through the town of Courtright that night to the wedding house. The first section was with fife and drum, the second a horse fiddler, third seashells and tin horns, all making this discordant music. Third section with seashells, tin horns, the fifth with goose quills, sixth with pans, and then two men behind, one blowing a ram's horn and three or four goose quills into it, and the other crowing like a rooster, whose voice echoed through the village decently. The rest of the story goes on in the letter. They reached the home, they surrounded it, they continued to play their rough music, they threw rocks at the through the windows, knocked out the lights, they set little fires around the house of brimstone to try to burn the smoke the folks out. They did come out, and there was a wedding reception going on. The wedding had happened earlier that day. They had a fight, and ultimately at some point they kind of ran off. But This was a 19th century Skimmington. Now, Skimmingtons, and again, we have dozens of examples of these. This happens to be a letter. You can find them in the newspapers or the court cases when they were brought to court. These Skimmingtons, or Skimmeltons now, just kind of a slight variation of the old term, are still, again, kind of violent, rustic, but more a certain playful edge to them, but threatening, but focused still on the household, but new marriages now, the beginning of a new family. But on, again, families that which the crowd or the town had some question about whether or not there should be, whether or not this was a marriage that should have happened. So a series of potential couples and marriages were targeted. A widow or a widower, particularly a widower remarrying, was often seen as a problem. Partly having to do with disbelief, because I should also point out, the Skimmingtonians tended to be young men, late teens and their 20s. And the argument was, this guy, he already had his chance in terms of, we have a village which is 50% men, 50% women. This guy has had his run, now trying for a second might be endangering their ability to get the wife of their choice. A big age difference between husband and wife would be also lead to a Skimmington or Skimmington, with the idea being that the chances perhaps of children less possible, less likely. Simply an unpopular bride or groom could lead to a Skimmington as well. Also, a young woman marrying someone from outside the village. We have examples of that. All of these things were seen as a challenge to the community in some way. And the community, or at least the young men who made up the Skimmingtonians, felt as though they had the right to judge what was going on in their town. Now, in the 1820s, 1830s, again, with dozens of these examples, they tended to be fairly bordering on violent. The violence in this one only really took place when the folks came out to do battle. I can read quickly from another one a few years later in Cairo, New York, in which it was also a widower who had just remarried on November 6th in 1825, and he's describing in his court case that around 8 o'clock on the night of his marriage, around 8 o'clock, he heard a great noise of drums, kettles, horns, bells, about half a mile distant. Then by 8 o'clock, they, the defendants, there are five people who were on trial, with many others, approached to the house in which he was married and commenced riding Skimmington. And they say in Dutch, so misunderstanding of the history of this term, because it was not a Dutch term, it was an English term. In English, riding the gray horse. Now, riding the gray horse is a term which was used much like Skimmington's, aimed at, again, a powerful woman, a dominant woman. So there's some inkling in here that not only is it a widower, but there is a fairly masterful or powerful woman that he is marrying. Simply referred to in the article, or the piece, as a spinster. It was a frolic. They were blowing horns, but they used the most abusive language. They tore the shingles from the roof. They went on the roof and threw bricks down the chimney, throwing them down the chimney, with many other outrages and decencies not proper nor necessary to be recapitulated. And then they took off. Again, just from the understanding of the event, it was, well, you could see on two counts it was probably a problematic marriage in terms of, again, a woman who was seen as too dominant for her gender and a widower who was remarried. Now, through the 1820s, 1830s, 1840s, we start to see these things taking place up and down the Hudson. In the 1840s, 1850s, they take on a new part. The Skimmingtonians, or the Skimmington Fiends, as they were sometimes called, or just the Skimmington Boys, or sometimes just called by the name of the town, the Newburgh Boys, the Kingston Boys, always young men that were involved. They would come and they would demand a fine. They wanted something in return. They were going to stay and play their discordant music. They wanted two things, usually. They wanted the new bride to come out to the front step, give a bow, kind of a twirl, and they wanted the new husband to pay a fine of either money or some alcohol, which they probably already been partaking in quite a bit before that happened. Many we don't know about. Everyone played their role. folks knew that they were targeted. The wife would come out and do that. The husband might give it a few dollars as a fine or some alcohol. They might play for a few minutes longer. This is in their description. And then they would march off. Everyone had done what they're supposed to do. The ones we tend to know the most about are the ones in which usually the couple that was being skinned, term that they used, they didn't do what they were supposed to do. They either rejected it, fought back, and that would usually lead to violence. And just to give you some examples, this is from the New York Times in 1884. After a wedding in Ulster County, New York, the other night, some of the people indulged in an old-fashioned skimmleton. Nothing better than having an old-fashioned skimmleton. It was 8 o'clock. The marriage ceremony was not finished when a crowd outside blew their horns. They fired shotguns, threw stones on the roof. This is a different story from the one that I described earlier in a different part of Hudson Valley. The house was riddled with buckshot. Cannon was fired. A musket was pointed at the head of the bride's father. The bride was insulted. And the road filled up with heavy timber, which the bridegroom had to go and cut away with an axe before the minister could go home. Part of the complaint of here was that it even happened while the minister was still in the house. The genial souls who made things so lively for the young couple and welcomed them so heartily to the rank of a blessing were tried for it. And at their performance, it was decided to be only an ordinary country skimmleton, and they were acquitted by a jury of their countrymen. So again, to give dozens of examples in the 19th century of skimmletons of this nature, and often going unpunished. Might go to court, but they found not guilty, as in this case. All the newspapers, the kind of local religious leaders were questioning whether or not this was a good thing to have happened. Let's come back to that. And here's kind of an image of a really more of a charivari in France, but similar to the idea of a skimmleton. But they began to change in the late 19th century. So for most of the 19th century, the skimmleton was this, brings to a close, skimmleton was this mocking, ridiculing of a new household, a new marriage, which folks had a problem. They felt as though, now, by the way, they never tried to stop the marriage. There's never an example where, because they knew these folks were gonna be married. So that was something which they always allowed. What they were doing was more or less saying, we judge every new marriage. The ones that are okay, we don't skimmleton. The ones that we have a problem with, we do. And again, throughout the 19th century, it became increasingly common to expect a fine, expect some sort of payment of alcohol. By the late 19th century, you start to see a change. And for some years, the newspapers, religious leaders, political leaders, government leaders are trying to stop these riots or saying, this is barbaric, it's kind of something from age-old time, time to do away with it. In the late 19th century, you start to see skimmletons start to happen at just about any marriage. Those that had problems with it, in terms of either age difference or whatever, and those that did not. It became much more of a community welcoming, in fact, by the late 19th, early 20th century. In a 20-year period of time, between the 1890s and like 1910, there's a huge shift. They don't stop. In fact, they grow in number. There are far more skimmletons now than there have been. 19th century, again, only aimed at problematic marriages. Now they became a way to welcome any new household into as part of the community. But I can't say just as quickly as that happened because they lasted for 40 more years. Through the 1930s, 1940s, 20s, 30s, they remained popular. This article from 1949 in the New York Herald Tribune. And it's skimmletons, a part of a way of life in the Catskills. And actually, it's kind of cute because what you can kind of see here in the drawing is folks are organizing their skimmleton on the phone or in the store. Here it is, they're ringing bells, they're banging pots and pans, but they're carrying the new groom out because, as the article explains, in this particular case, it's kind of a joke, he didn't have the requisite cigars for the men or the candy for the ladies that was what he was supposed to produce. And so what they're doing was rushing him to the local grocery store, which they opened up so he could do that. Now, this article even points out, 1949, that the skimmleton is dying, or fewer and fewer of them. They may have been very popular, still popular in the Catskills, and that might say something in terms of a generation behind us. But by certainly into the 1950s, 1960s, you started to see the custom come to an end. I mean, there's a variety of reasons for this, why they even became more community-oriented, why they died out, but they were always a little bit different from, again, a wedding reception. Now, two things I just want to close on. Well, you know what? Yeah. Actually, I could show this one first. By the early 20th century, this is about 1920. It's, again, bride and groom have a skimmington. The skimmington, and sometimes they use the original term, not a skimmington, the old skimmington term showing its connection, was combined with a shower. Many useful and lovely gifts were received by the bride. So instead of this crowd of rowdy young men who had been drinking coming to the front door demanding a fine, now the skimmington crowd brought gifts to the family. So a total reversal there as well. However, where does it end up? It ends up in Red Hook. In 1907. And in Red Hook, Frederick Lee, who was a just married Miss Anna Rogers, and they returned to their future home in Red Hook, north of Dutchess County, one evening last week. The young man had been in the lumber business, and all of his neighbors turned out to welcome the couple in a country style in what the wood folk call the skimmington party, a provincialism for a char bar. Mr. Lee resolved that he would not be skimmed, and neither would the bride go out and make her bow to the boys, beating tin pans, wash boilers, playing cowbells, so any type of rough music, discord music, and other music of the countryside was kept up for an hour, and the disappointing serenaders finally voiced their dissent in jeers and insults. This brought the enraged bridegroom forth. The crowd gathered, expecting to get the cigars, price of a can of beer. Instead, they were told by him, "I'm tired of this. You fellas clear out, or I'll pepper you all the shot. I'll shoot low, but I'll shoot." When the shooting low or better? With jeers, the crowd renewed their demonstrations, and Lee closed the door. He opened it again, discharged a shotgun loaded with birdshot, and then went peacefully to bed. And then it points out that no one was actually injured in it, except slightly, but not badly. By the way, this was much more along the lines of a more modern skimmington. A large part of the crowd were from the community. They did want a gift. It was a little raucous, but certainly at a time when it had become a little friendlier. So clearly not welcomed by everyone. I didn't want to do that. This just made it even smaller. But I'm going to close there, and just on this map by a linguist back in 1947, Hans Kluge, Word Geography in the United States. And it's a linguistic analysis of different terms and different words. And it's a look at the kind of wedding serenades and how their names change from region to region. Chivalry, serenade, very common ones, but if you see, does this have a little pointer left? Right here, there we are, the skimmington. For whatever reason, only that region, the Hudson Valley, southwestern Connecticut, northeastern New Jersey, and I think there is a reason for that, but I'll be getting that in terms of the questions. So this was an old-fashioned skimmington. It changed dramatically over the course of 400 years, but it always had a common goal. Its common goal was to try to adjudicate what is the domestic situation in a household supposed to look like. In the 17th century, they thought it was supposed to be clear gender hierarchy. Woman was too powerful, got to have a skimmington. In the 18th century, in the Hudson Valley, it became something which was focused on men who were abrogating their responsibility as good fathers and good husbands through some illicit activity. A skimmington aimed at them. In the 19th century, mismarriages, marriages that the community of the town thought shouldn't be taking place, became the focus. Again, it's about the household, it's about the relationship between the husband and the wife. And by the 20th century, it became this friendly, neighborly kind of event in which the town came out to welcome the new household, even though they hadn't been invited to the wedding. And they were sending a message, though, they had some say in the new household in their town. they were going to participate in one way or the other, and hence the Skimmelton. And I'll open it up to any questions you may have. It knew it was done.
Oh, what timing?
It ran off on its own. Only because.
Go back. Let me just plug it in. It's only time for the battery.
In case the question may.
Okay.
Well, any questions? That was just kind of a run through four centuries.
Jeez.
And by the way, I have records of about 150 Skimmeltons. Hundreds more that you'll see in the newspaper, I don't even bother, because it's just like some of the ones in the 20th century, it's just a party and just a friendly thing. Much more interested actually in the 18th, 19th century ones, when they were a little more raucous. But there's plenty of them out there. Yes, sir?
I'm curious as to what effect, or what the impact was. It seems to have died out because of television.
In the 1950s, 1960s, because the last one that there is a record of is in the Catskills in 1962. And there was some mention of the fact that, even of that one, that they were becoming less and less popular. In fact, that seems to be the last one that was recorded. It certainly could be. There's a variety of factors in place in the early 20th century. And by the 1930s, 1940s, increasingly, more and more neighborhoods were made up of folks who perhaps did not even know each other as well as they had previously, post-World War II in particular. Folks that just happened to live in the same kind of town, same part of town. The old kind of neighborliness, or neighboriness term used to be used, an interconnection between families that lived in a community had kind of disappeared, and so that may have gone by the wayside as well. But it does, certainly by post-World War II, because they seem to be still fairly common right through the 1930s, and plenty of examples from the 40s, but then they do start to quickly die out. Could be more of a mass audience. Yes, I'm just gonna. Yes.
Oh, to back that up as well, I'm also studying the trend of social activities in our communities that drop off. And it's the same era. You've got TV and cars and post-war that just cuts it in half and then it just drops from there. So it's not just an activity like this, it's other social activities,
sure.
Like being involved in your Grange or throwing parties and just going to somebody's house and having a party on Wednesday night. Mm-hmm. People just don't do it anymore on Christmas. They can sit home and watch TV.
And on that note, I think it's a good point just to put this in the context of many other types of things. The Skimmelton is just one form of popular culture and public life, which was very powerful, that's about. I happen to like things like this because they're a little bit outside the norm. They're a little bit under the radar. They're not institutional. It's not like celebrating Christmas or July 4th, which everyone did. This is something which kind of was from the ground up. This was a custom which folks had. Lots of other customs in Hudson Valley, 18th, 19th century. And this is kind of one of them in that way. So I think it is important to see it in a bigger context of lots of different other social and cultural activities. And the other thing is just to connect it up. Back in the late 19th century, when they moved from being those kind of ridiculing or mocking the new household, potentially violent men, to being these friendly kind of barn warmings, barn raisings that think of in the late 19th and early 20th century, could also be related, although you'll never find a perfect set of variables which would play this out. Late 19th century, you start to see more and more folks from towns and villages in the Hudson moving to the big city, too. So the big growth area at the time of the first half of the 19th century began to decline. And it could be folks looking at the starting of a new household, whether one that was popular or unpopular, as still a good thing. It's another family in the town that we did not have before. And these are very rural, rustic events, right? Particularly in the 18th and 19th century. So by the 19-teens, 20s, 30s, they were taking place, again, in like Rhinebeck, Red Hook, Poughkeepsie, which were a little less rustic and rural. But by and large, these are, you don't find these in Manhattan. These are more rural things. You had your Claudia, and then.
So my question was, do you have a theory as to why it's unique to the Hudson Valley? Valley, or is it just a different version of the same kind of custom elsewhere in rural areas?
No, that's a great point, great question. There is a difference among these things. On the one hand, the chivalry, if you remember back at the beginning, I never explained it, but it was the term charivari. Charivari is essentially the French version of everything I've been describing, usually aimed at a whole variety of different types of events. So charivari was a group from the town, the village, that would come out, again, usually theatrically, to try and send a message against someone who was doing something which they found either illegal or troubling. The rough music, and that term kind of is used by historians very broadly. But charivari also were aimed at weddings or new marriages, particularly marriages between, again, a big age difference was a problem among those in charivari. But charivari is French. Charivari was brought to North America by the French when they settled New France, and they settled south along the Louisiana, Alabama areas, and charivaris took place there in the 17th and 18th century. In fact, the first charivari we have is 1683 in Montreal, in which a widow remarried only a few weeks after her husband had died, and the crowd, the folks went home for 3 nights with torches around her home, saying the term charivari, charivari. She shouldn't have done this. The chivalry, which is very popular past the Mississippi, is a simply an alteration of the word charivari. So the chivalry, which is probably the most common of kind of wedding celebrations of this nature, is the one that took place west of the Mississippi. Serenade also has certain French, but also English aspects. The Skimmington is different. The Skimmington, not only in terms of just the Hudson Valley, and it's just important for that reason, of course, it's here in our homes. The Skimmington worked off of a different tradition. It was an English tradition, unlike the others. It worked off of a tradition, again, of a much more violent kind of communal policing back in the 18th century. But this is just a theory, which I'm sure is wrong. But why it's in the Hudson Valley and northern New Jersey and southwestern Connecticut, I do think has something to do with that misquote back in the 1820s that this was a Dutch term. It is an English term. However, it took place in a part of New York. The Hudson Valley is the one area of the original 13 colonies in which there was another language, a Germanic language, Dutch, which was in competition with English right through, right up to the Revolutionary War, in fact, and beyond. It went to Kingston during the Revolution for Dutch more than for English. So I think it has something to do with kind of the imprint of the areas that had been settled by the Dutch, that this term took shape there, and other terms like serenade and chivalry and belling and horning, which are very, they're very prosaic, right? Belling, yeah, because they were ringing bells and they're blowing horns. They're very mundane, unlike a term like skimmleton, which has, again, its own history. I'm sure it's wrong. Yes.
Oh, I just wanted to follow up because Sarah had pointed out something to me, and we wondered if you encountered white capping in the late 19th century.
Yes.
So, because this was, Sarah pointed it out, a good example that happened here in Jackson Corners was that a married man was working on a farm, started to get a little too friendly with the farmer's daughter, took the farmer's daughter away for some sort of visit to Jackson Corners. And while they were at the, and he became this target of white capping, which I guess was you get a notice on the door that you gotta get out of town or else. And he was tarred and feathered in Jackson Corners, and they let her just run away. But and I didn't know, does that start to get into the KKK? It was very much a moral police, but they had white caps.
White capping is exactly that. Starts in the mid-19th century, 1850s, 1860s. Very popular more to the Midwest, Iowa, Idaho, Michigan. And in fact, they dress kind of like Klan's men, the white cap. And as you pointed out, there was often a warning, maybe first stop, and second, get out of town, kind of thing. Or third, railings, tarring and feathering, exactly that. It was less common in New York, although there are examples in the Hudson Valley throughout the 1880s, 1890s of white capping. One similar to that in Marlboro or Milton, New York. One group of lady Whitecaps in Neversink in Sullivan County. A husband who had been was drunk all the time, not taking care of his family. He got a note on the door.
Yeah.
Don't drink again. And that night, of course, as he did, the lady Whitecaps grabbed him, beat him, dragged him through the water. We don't know what happened after that. I don't know this one in Jackson Corners. I'd like to know more about that. But so the Whitecapping was similar to skimmington in the sense that there could be a railing, there could be a beating. Remember, very often might just be a beating as opposed to a railing or a riding. But it was more about moral issues, morality, behavior, illicit activities that someone might be engaged in. Or again, the husband or father who wasn't doing what he was supposed to do to take care of his family. Different from clan activity, of course, which was race-related and so forth, and political. And the Whitecaps generally didn't have that angle to it. They were very big in the 1860s, 1870s, 1880s. Again, more in the Midwest and towards the Plain States, but New York had them as well.
I think this article said something like that they had organized a Whitecap committee. So yeah, it wasn't like we got our Whitecap people together. You know, it was just ad hoc.
But there are examples, and then that just kind of died out. Now there was a hand over here. Right here. Yes.
So with the violent skimmingtons, does your research show that? They were carried out against people of a certain race or religion or social group?
They're all against white males that we have. So it does have a racial component, but it's not aimed at a minority group or slaves. The skimmingtons we have records of. So they're gendered except for the one in, I mentioned that one, aimed at a prostitute in Fishkill, and there's some other issues with that one too, with who was actually the target, may have been the guy. So it is, whether it's in the Hudson Valley, where most of them were, but there are examples that pushed into Rhode Island. There's a couple from Rhode Island, and a couple in southern Massachusetts on the border of Rhode Island that we know of too, called skimmingtons. John Adams actually makes a comment on skimmingtons. In 1793, there were riots at the brothels and houses of prostitution in New York City, called the Bawdy House Riots is what they were called. But Adams makes reference to it in a letter to Abigail saying, he thought this was a problem. The mobility. As a mob kind of gone wild. He said, except for those things known as skimmington ridings that have a real moral component to it. He said, those are crowd actions I can deal with. So he makes a reference to that. All of the examples in New England are also are all either a man who was involved in some sort of illicit affair. Actually, there's one exactly described here. Jonathan Shepperton is having an affair, the rest of the community expects, with a young woman who was staying on his farm. His wife is there as well, and he is Rhodes Skimmington. Something else is going to say. In certain parts of New England, well, Duxbury and some other towns, there's something called Skimmington Foolers, and these were less violent, but certainly embarrassing, in which the case we have is a guy who was forced to march through the town, with the crowd around him in blackened face and described as, in the time, dressed as Negroes. Symbolically a lesser group in the 18th century, parading this guy around, the guy at the front dressed in a judge's surplice. And it was an embarrassing, humiliating march through town. So there, but again, it's a white male and a father who was, they described as being cruel to his family.
So the victims were, generally speaking, white Anglo-Saxon men, and the crimes were committed by white Anglo-Saxon men.
Sometimes of Dutch background.
Sometimes of Dutch background.
To Anglo-Saxon, but certainly the guy targeted in Fishkill is John Vandeweer, someone clearly of Dutch background, but there were Dutch folks that were involved. There was a Brinkerhoff involved in the crowd as well. So there doesn't seem to have been an ethnic component to it. The examples that still not found, might reveal that to be totally wrong. And I'm sorry, there was another hand right here, and then.
It sounds to me like a community-based gang attempt at social justice, whatever that meant at the time.
Yeah, I think that's why.
Dishonor, respect.
Yeah, that's how they certainly would describe it too. And I mean, think about it in terms of the an adulterous husband, there's his own family, there's the other families involved in a small community, there's a variety of problems that have emerged from this, which are not always kind of religious and moral ones from the perspective of the rest of the community. This type of activity is going to impact, you know, our relatives over here, our friends over there. So they try to bring things in line. So it was an 18th century form of social justice as they would have defined it. And again, there's very few legal recourses for folks on things like this. So this is what they would more or less have to do if they were going to get this situation resolved. Yes, sir.
Do you know if the custom evolved in a similar manner over in Southwest England? Did it continue on over there?
Yeah, no, that's a great question, because they're very popular in England. They continue, but the main focus of the Skimmington Rye remained a domineering wife or woman. Skimmington Rides or Riding Skimmity, you can find them, and Thomas Hardy has them, both in The Mayor of Casterbridge and Return of the Native, sometimes related to a marriage, but one that was seen as unpopular, usually because of the exceptionable character of the young wife or young bride. So it did broaden as well. So you might have ridings, Riding the Stang, again, a skimmity ride, which might be aimed at a variety of different groups. But in England, the most popular one still remained Masterful Woman. It's their term. I think it's a great term.
To what extent does religion factor? Were there more common certain religious groups as opposed to others? Did church leaders call for them or discourage their use?
Well, church leaders had a problem with them because they write about, as a matter of fact, the title of one article written by this is in northeastern New Jersey, by a minister after the, what exactly is the title of that? After the ritual of the minister is done, the ritual of the crown begins. And it was a criticism of this because he argued you were bringing into disrepute the very powerful and important sacrament legal aspect of marriage by, you know, making fun of it in this ridiculing, mocking way people behaved. So there was lots of pushback from that. There's no religious component to it that I can see in North America, in English North America. However, in New France and Canada, the charivari and the chivalry, the Catholic Church definitely had a problem with it because this was, you were making fun of the sacrament of marriage. And so that example I gave in 1683, the bishop or some leading priest figure in Montreal threatened the rest of the community with some sort of excommunication or not being allowed to take in the communion if they didn't stop it, because they were making, again, they were, the church had control over marriage and remarriage, not the crowd, was more or less his take. So the Catholic Church in France and in Canada constantly had a problem. Now, charivaris that happen in Canada are very colorful. The ones in the Skimmeltons might be this gang of rustic guys marching with discordant music, drinking too much, singing coarse songs. Those in Canada, they would dress up. Some would dress up as priests, others would dress up in other costumery, and they would do similar things and also demand a fine, but worked much more fully off of the religious symbolism that Catholicism had that generally the other groups didn't. Did I answer that question?
Yeah. This is kind of an oblique reference. The word Shiva is an Indian word that Shiva is the creator god.
Right.
Okay, now in India, there is a tradition that transvestites in costumes, go to weddings and they go to housewarmings, new housewarmings. I've been at a housewarming where I saw these people, and they dance and sing and make a lot of noise. And they are given, it's supposed to be bad luck if you don't give them money. So it's like a very oblique reference, but Shiva is mentioned.
Well, two things to that reference, which I cannot speak to beyond what you described, because I know very little about that outside of Shiva being the
creator god.
Creation, right? Is that the chivalry, in this case, is really working off of kind of a bastardization of the term charivari, the French, and you can kind of see a chivalry charivari. However, there are cases of chivalries in Missouri in the 18-teens and 1820s in which the men dressed as women marched around the town saying charivari, actually. Although I don't know how that fits anymore.
I don't know, it is, but it has an older culture than we are.
Yeah, but,
and the word Shiva is a creator god.
But it would not have been uncommon in other places for transvestites, folks to dress, usually men dressing as women, not as often women dressing as men. Actually, I don't know of a single example of women dressing as men as part of that, but certainly men dressing as women. There was another hand.
The Molly Maguire's dressed as women as well, didn't they?
They did when they were engaging in their activities, right?
Yeah, so I wonder, did they borrow it from the, like, just this idea of some kind of inversion or statement in their labor situation?
I don't know the earliest examples, so I don't know how far it goes back, but I know, like, and I haven't studied it in that way, but like anthropologists and historians that look at it often view it in the context of, in the same way that certain types of rioting that would take place here in Hudson Valley, for example, were women that would be dictating the riots, not dressed as women, actual women, that something about that the authorities would respond differently. Skimmington, there was a, you know what, there's another whole series of riots called the Skimmington Riots in England in the 1740s, 1750s, which have nothing to do with this, but are men dressed as women. They dress in the rioters in the Catskills and in the Helderbergs, the anti-rent rioters in the 1830s and 1840s, dressed in calico gowns and masks, but dressed as women. They often were using their sisters' or wives' dresses. So sometimes it's just disguise. Sometimes you could disguise yourself a lot different, though. So there's something to it in terms of why they're doing it. But there probably has something to do with that, a belief that women rioting, there was something okay about that in the 17th and 18th century. Not citizens, that they're rioting for certain reasons, and still should be stopped, but would be viewed differently. So there might be some form of gender inversion there in terms of the men just dressing as women, but not sure any more than that. But lots of, there are plenty of examples of rioters. So something about that, some sort of activity like that, dressing as one. That's a whole other talk.
We could go on. Fascinating stuff that normally you deliver to students, but we are fortunate to have you share it with us outside of the classroom.
I haven't taught a class in years. So
but you did.
But I did. This is the first time I've actually presented this.
So, is that right?
Yeah.
Or are we even more honored?
We'll work off and make it a little bit better next time.
And thank you to Julia for Panda. So we're going to be able to see this on the But for now, please join us in the tap room. And I'm sure Tom will stick around in case we have more questions.